morning, friends. I welcome you all in this session. As you are aware, in previous class we were discussing how to present categorical and non-categorical data, or metric or non-metric data. Today we'll see some of the other methods of presenting numerical data. So let's look at polygon. As we have already seen in previous session, that histogram is one of the methods of data presentation. Just look at this. Now the polygon is similar to histogram. Only the point is, you need to connect midpoints of these classes, then it becomes a polygon, right? This you can see in next slide, right? So what is a polygon? Is formed by collecting the midpoints together, right? Now midpoints, how would you get? Each class will have a midpoint, right? Let's say if it is, let's say the class interval is, let's say 1 to 10, so midpoint would be 5, right? A cumulative percentage polygon, you can also call it ogive, right? It displays the variable of interest along x axis and the cumulative percentage, right, along y axis, okay? So that is the difference between percentage polygon and a polygon. A polygon will connect all the midpoints, but it would be a cumulative. In case of ogive, it would be a cumulative percentage. Useful when you want to compare two groups of data, right? So this is a frequency polygon. We'll take the same example. So the midpoint for first interval is, for first class is 15, and for the last one it is 55, right? So this is 55. So you just connect all these midpoints. Now this is your frequency polygon. If you write over here percentage, then it would become percentage polygon. Ogive, as I said, is nothing but a cumulative percentage polygon. So rather than connecting midpoints of histogram, here you have got a cumulative percentage, right? So let's say the first one is 15, right? So this is 15. So for ogive, you have got the upper limit is the base, right? So at this point you need to have this point. Similarly, next is 30, so this is 30, and this is the next one is next cumulative percentage, okay? And similarly, you can have, for example, the first one is 15, right? So this 15, next is 45, this 45, right? Next is 70, so this 70, isn't it? And so on. So finally, this one is 100. So this is ogive. Now, so far what we have done, we have represented numerical and non-numerical data in different forms, be it tabular form, chart, bar chart, or pie chart, or histogram, or whatever it is. But there are certain limitations of those charts, and the limitation is that we can use all of them only for one particular variable of interest. Now many times what happens, you have got more than one variables and you need to find out some relationship between those two variables, or you may have more than two variables as well, isn't it? So when you have got two variables, then frequency distribution will not work, or polygon will not work. Then what you need? You need something called cross tabulations. So cross tabulations we generally use for two or more variables, especially categorical variables, okay? And cross tabulations can be presented in terms of contingency tables, right? So we'll have a table in next slide that would be called contingency table, right? So a contingency table presents the result of two categorical variables, as I have already mentioned. The joint responses are classified so that the categories of one variable are located in the rows and the other variable are located in column, right. So, you will have some rows and some columns in contingency table. The cell is intersection of row and column, and the value in each cell represents the data corresponding to that specific pairing of row and column. So, let us look at an example. So, this is your cross tabulation. So, let us say you have done a study and you have asked to, let us say, 7500 respondent, and the question you have asked them is whether the brand which they are using is more important than what it used to be earlier, right. So, the question was whether the brand which you are using is now more important than what it was earlier, and data were collected from 7500 respondents. Now, there are, as I said, cross tabs are for two variables. So, which are two variables? So, we collected data, let us say, from 3750 males and the same number of females in your survey. So, you have got males and females, right. Now, 750 respondent have said that the importance of brand is now more than what it used to be earlier, and 6750 said no, it is not more, but it is equal or less than that. So, there are two variables. Which are two variables? Which are two categorical variables? Can you identify from this table? The first one is gender, right. So, gender, you have female and males, right. And the second one is the brand, is not it? So, brand has again got two categories, whether it is more preferred than earlier or it is less than or equally preferred, right. So, this is how you can have use of cross tabulation. Now, as I said, there are thousands of data representation tools, or charts, graphs, or plots, whatever you call them. Now, there is something called scatter plot. Now, scatter plot is again a type of plot wherein you are using two numerical variables, right. So, you can find out actually a relationship between these two variables, whether they are related or not. First of all, if related, then whether they are positively related or not related. So, you have got two numerical variables. On one axis you have got one variable and the other one would be on horizontal axis. As I said, it used to examine possible relationship between two numerical variables. So, let us look at an example. So, volume per day and cost per day. Let us say you are manufacturing some, let us say, liquid, right. Liquid, let us say beverages, right. So, let us say from the assembly line you are making, let us say, 23 liter of beverage, and the cost is 125 rupees per day. Similarly, for 60 liters of beverage, the cost is 200, and there are other values in between. So, you can have these two axes. So, on x axis you have got volume per day, and on y axis you have got cost per day, right. So, we want to find out, is there any relationship. So, this is how you can draw a scatter plot like this. So, the first one is 23. So, this is 23 and this value is 125, okay, and so on. So, finally, this one is 60 and 200, right. So, this is your 200 point, right. So, if you connect all these point, you know, dots, and this becomes a scatter plot. So, do you see, is there any relationship? Yes, there is a relationship. You can say that as the volume per day increases, the cost also increases slightly, isn't it? So there is a positive relationship. When the variable on x axis increases, the variable on y axis also increases. So this is a case of positive relationship. So this is scatter plot. Let's look at another plot. It's called time series plot. Now time series plot and scatter plot, these two are almost similar, only there is one difference, that in time series plot on x axis you will always have time, right, and on y axis you will have a particular variable, right. So this is again for two variables. Variable 1 is on x axis, let us call it time, and variable y is some other variable. So let us say the number of franchises of a product or of a firm in 1996 were 43 and in 2004 95 and other values in between. So how would you plot time series plot? So you just take on x axis, this is your time, and on y axis is your number of franchise. So the difference between scatter plot and time series plot is here you will always have time on x axis. Now whenever you go for drawing graphs, there are certain principles, some guidelines which you should keep in mind. So the graph should not distort the data, because whenever you collect data you should represent in a graph properly. You should not distort the data while preparing a graph. Graph should not contain unnecessary adornments. So you just you should not try to give each and every information in the graph. You just give whatever is required. The scale on the vertical axis should always begin at 0, right. We will see example of each one of these points, okay. All axes should be properly labeled. Labeled means whether x axis is time or let us say volume or cost or whatever it is, right. The graph should contain a title. Of course, it's good to have title in each and every graph. So the simplest possible graph should be used for a given set of data, right. So let us look at some of the examples of graphs. So this is a you have got a data. So the minimum wage in 1996 is $1, 1970 $1.6, 1990 $3.8, right. So is this a good representation? No, this is not a good representation, this is a bad presentation of data. So what is wrong here? Can you think for a while, what is wrong in this particular slide? The point here is that you can have a better graph by having time on x axis and on y axis wages, isn't it? So let's look at this. This is how you should represent. So in 1960 this is the wage 1, and in 1990 wage is $3.8, right. So try to avoid making such mistakes. Let's look at another example. Now if you look at this, this is again a bad presentation of data. So let us say these are different, let us say grade A received by students. So freshmen, these many students received grade A, juniors these many, seniors these many, right. So there is a better way of presenting same information, and how you can do it? Just think for a while, just for 30 seconds. How would you improve presentation of this information? So you can do it by having all these students on x axis, just like here we have given, but on y axis you can have percentage frequency, right, percentage frequency. Okay, let us look at this, just see this, 0%, 10%, 20%, 30%, right. So, this is a good presentation of info data. Okay. So, let us look at one more example. This data, right. So, quarterly sales, first quarter, second quarter, third and fourth quarter, right. So, quarterly sales over here is this, for second quarter this, third and fourth is this, right. So, what's wrong here? Just 10 seconds. What is wrong here? Now, if you look at this particular graph, then this point is 0, absolutely right, but all these, the maximum value is, let us say this is 40 or 50, right, but all this value and this value do not have any meaning, is not it? So, you can prepare a better graph. So, start with 0, then 25, next value is let us say 50 and so on, right. So, here you can easily identify what was the, you know, quarterly sales, let us say in Q3. So, this comes around let us say 37.5, right, but from here you do not know how much it is, is not it? So, this is a better graph. Let us look at this one. What is wrong here? It is very simple, written here, no 0 point on vertical axis. So, monthly sales from January to June. So, in month of January it is let us say 42, but you should always begin y axis with 0 point, right. So, this would be 0, then 36 and so on, right. So, this is a good presentation and this is a bad presentation. Okay. So, let us summarize what we did in this session so far and what we did in previous session. So, we have seen how to organize categorical data in terms of table, pie chart, bar chart or Pareto chart, how to organize numerical data in terms of stem and leaf diagram, frequency distribution, polygon, ogive and histogram. We have examined, we have also seen what is cross tabulation, as I said, when there are two or more variables, right, then use cross tabs. We have also seen scatter plot and time series plot, and we have seen do's and don'ts of graphing. Okay. So, let us look at next topic, which is numerical descriptive measures. Now, what we will see in this particular session is, we will talk about different measures of central tendency, different measures of dispersions. So, first of all, you should know what is central tendency. Whenever you have got data, there would be one point on which all data would be resting or lying upon or dependent upon. So, that point is known as central tendency. So, let us say you have got a distribution of data, for example, let us say these data, this is your distribution, right. So, you can say that this is the point where this particular distribution rests, right. So, this would be called central tendency. Now, since your data would be different, right, it would not always be normally distributed data, you will have skewed data. In most of the times you will see skewed data, right? So this is central tendency. The variation is the amount of dispersion or scattering of values. So what is dispersion? So let's say let's take an example. So this is your distribution, right? And this is your another distribution, right? So which one is more dispersed? This one is more dispersed than this, right? Here you have got data concentrated, right? Here they are dispersed, right? So we'll central tendency, variation, and there is something called shape, is the pattern of the distribution of the value from lowest value to the highest value. So how this shape is changing in the distribution. Now there is something called kurtosis. Kurtosis is the how the height of distribution, right? So for a normally distributed data, the skewness is 0 and kurtosis is 3. So this is one of the ways of defining normal distribution, that for a normally distributed data, kurtosis is 3 and dispersion is 0, right? And skewness is 0, right? So let's look at different measures of central tendency. The very first and most important is mean, or you can simply call it arithmetic mean or average, is the most common measure of central tendency for a simple of size n. So let's say there are different data points, so x1 2, let's say x1 xn. So you just take summation of all these data and divide it by n, right? So this is your x bar, right? So I is ranging from 1 to n, right? And n is the sample size. So this is, and all these are your observed values. So this is how you can calculate mean. Let's take this example. So it's a most common measure. Mean is equal to sum of values divided by number of values affected by extreme values. So this is basically a disadvantage of mean when you calculate, when you take this as a measure of central tendency. So let's take this example. So you have got, let's say, data point 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So what is the mean? You just take summation of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and divide it by 5. So this mean, right? Let's look at this example. So this is, there are two examples, this first example, this second example. So data points are 1, 2, 3, 4 and 10. This is mean is 4. So as I said, if you look at these 5 data points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, mean is 3, but if you take 5 data points here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and this is 10, right? So you can say that this is an outlier, okay? Though there are different methods of finding outliers, but here just by looking at this pattern, you can see 10 is an outlier. That is why the mean has gone up from 3 to 4. So not a very good method or measure of central tendency, okay? Let's look at another method. It's called a mean for grouped data. So you can have two types of data, grouped data and ungrouped data. What is the difference? Grouped data is a data wherein you are grouping data by writing frequencies in different classes. So frequency distribution is nothing but a kind of grouped data, right? So let's say you have got data points, let's say 10, 13, 15 and 20, right? Okay, so this is ungrouped data. But let's say if I want to have two classes, let's say 10 to 15 and 15 to 20. These two are different classes. So 10 to 15, there are two data points. So this is frequency, this is your class interval, right? So frequency 2 and frequency 2 here, right? So this becomes grouped data, right? So how would you calculate mean in this case? x bar is equal to summation of fx divided by n, right, where of course this is mean and this is summation of cross products of frequency in each class with midpoint of each class, and this is important, right. So, x is nothing but midpoint of each class and n is total number of observations or total frequency, right. So, we will take an example and we will calculate mean of grouped data. So, let us take this example, find the arithmetic mean of the following continuous frequency distribution. So, there are six classes, first, second, third, fourth, fifth and sixth, right, and you have been given frequencies as well. So, frequency in first, in class 1 is 0 to 1 is the interval is 1, frequency here is in class interval 2 to 3 is 8, and when frequency is 2, the class interval is 5 to 6, right. So, how would you find mean of grouped data? So, first of all, you need to calculate midpoint of each class, is not it? So, what would be the midpoint of class 1 or this class 0 and 1, midpoint is 0.5, is not it, for this 1.5, right, and so on, for this 5.5, is not it? So, all these are x values, right. So, just see this. So, all these are your classes and this is midpoint, 0.5 to 5.5, and of course, you have got frequencies. So, 1 to 2, right. So, total frequencies 25. So, fx is this. So, column A, B, C and D, right. So, this is fx. So, just multiply column B and C, you will get these values, and this is the mean, right, and this is the total of the, this is the total, right, total is here 75.5. So, just 75.5 divided by 25, you will get 3.02 as mean, right. So, this very simple method of calculating mean for grouped data. So, let us move on to one more example wherein there is grouped data available, and the example is like this. So, you have collected data of 600 account holders in a bank, and you want to know what is the mean balance in all those 600 accounts. So, when you collected data of 600 customers, you found that there were 78 such account holders who were having their balance between 0 to these many rupees. This is as good as 50, right. Similarly, there were only 4 accounts in which the balance was between 450 to 499.99 or 450 to 500. So, how would you solve this example? It is very simple. You have been given frequencies, you have been given class intervals, you just write down midpoints, right. Midpoint. What would be the midpoint here? Let's take this as 50, right. So, first midpoint would be 25, then 75 and so on, and the finally, it would be 475, right. So, just multiply f and x, right. This is f and this x. Take the total of f and x. So, this is summation of f x. You have got total frequency 600, you just divide it by 600, you will get mean, right. So, this is how you can solve this example, ok. So, f x in this case is 85350, is not it? This is nothing but 85350, right, 85350. So, divide this value by 600, you will get mean as 142.25. So, this is how you can calculate mean of grouped data and ungrouped data, right. So, let us look at another method of calculating mean using coding. Now, this is a simpler method by which you can get answer easily. Now, coding means what? We generally give different codes to these classes. For example, let us say since here you have got how many? 6 classes, right? So, you can give coding, let us say 0 to class number 3, then minus 1 to this class and minus 2 to class number 1, right? Similarly, 1, 2 and 3. Now, the next step is just multiply, so let us call this as x value, right? This is nothing but code, right? Now, multiply x and f, right? X and f. So, this becomes, let us say this is minus 4, minus 6, 3, sorry, this is 0, right? 3 into 0 is 0, this is 5, this is 4 and this is 6, right? So, this total is now what? You just this 4 and 6, you can cancel with this 4 and 6, so remaining is 5. So, this is 5, right? Now, how to proceed further? So, mean is equal to x 0 plus w into summation of u into f. So, let us call it u rather than calling it x, right? This is u, right? So, this is also u, right? Now, x 0 is the value of the midpoint assigned codes 0, value of the midpoint assigned code 0. So, code 0 is assigned to this particular class, and what is the midpoint of this? So, let us say, so the midpoint of this class would be 3.5, then this would be 11.5, this would be 19.5, is not it? So, that is the mid value assigned to code 0, right? Then numerical width of the class interval is 8, right? So, this how you can proceed further. So, this is your summation of u and f. Now, x 0 is, as I have already mentioned, is this 19.5, right? Plus w. What is w? Numerical width. So, this is width, right? 0, 8, 16 minus 8 is 8 and so on, right? This is summation of u and f, which is 5 divided by n. N is this 20. So, this becomes 21.5 as the mean. Now, in this case, what we have done? We have assigned 0 code to class number 3, right? So, there is no fixed rule that you should assign 0 code to let us say 3rd or 4th or 5th, whatever it is. You can assign 0 code to any of these class intervals. There is no change in answer. So, let us move forward and change this code and assign this code 0 to class number this, which is 4th class, right? So, 21 to 31 is now we have assigned 0 code. Now, this is minus 1, this is minus 2 and this is minus 3, this is 1 and this is 2, right? Now, what would be the u and f multiplication? So, this is u and this is f, right? So, this is minus 6, then 6 and minus 2, minus 12. The next one would be 3 and minus 1, minus 3. Then 5 into 0 is 0, 2 into 1 is equal to 2, 2 into 2 is equal to 4. Now, you can calculate what this summation would be. So, this would be minus 15. So, this 6 and this 6 gone, right? So, this is minus 12, minus 3, minus 15. Now, this minus 15, you need to put it in formula. So, what would be the mean now? Mean is equal to x 0 is the midpoint of the class where we have assigned 0. So, this is what would be the midpoint here? For this, it would be 27.5, right? So, 27.5 plus 8, into minus 15 divided by 20. Okay. So, this summation of u and f is minus 15 and we are dividing it by n, which is 20. So, this value is approximately, anyway, you will get this answer 21.5. So, this is, let us like calculate, minus 3, 4, this is 4, you just divide it by, so 8 divided by 4, this is 2. So, 2 into minus 3 is minus 6. So, 27 plus minus 6, which is equal to 21.5. So, this is another method of calculating mean using coding. So, with this let me complete this session. We will see some more methods in next session. Thank you.